information front, Tsietse Mashinini can best be described as a master architect, a designer of a good cause, and an executor of the outcomes of liberation. The description fits the man fueled by the wish which Nina Simone so soulfully sang about in his song entitled, How I Wish I Knew How It Would Feel to Be Free. Incidentally, Nina Simone was a composer of a song to be young, gifted, and black. But the song that drove her message to the heart was How I Wish I Knew How It Would Feel to Be Free. Mashinini's consciousness was born out of the environment that presented his questioning mind with the nightmares of degradation of a people he was fated to fight against. His leadership qualities and spirituality were steeped in the search for a godly existence, yearned for by his father, Ramotibi, who was a lay preacher of the Methodist Church. His mother, Nomkhita, was just as religious. It is to these parents that Tsietse Mashinini was born on January 27, 1975. No, sorry. I've got my birthday wrong there.
Yeah, sure.
1957.
Thank you.
Since Tsietse's upbringing was preoccupied with searching for a godly existence, which saw his parents take refuge in the church, it was inevitable that he would land himself in the political movement that had the courage to ask even the supreme being the question, Senzenina. Not only did Tsietse's spiritual path follow the footsteps of his parents, but also became the chair of the Methodist Church Youth Guild at the age of 16. Most people challenge, accept leadership at the age of 21, given a key by tradition of their parents. Tsietse had taken leadership at 16. In 1971, he was in the eyes of his English and history teacher, Onkho Potsetiro, a student of note at Morris Isaacson with a passion for reading. Tiro was a former student at the University of Teflon. He was expelled for a speech he delivered at the graduation ceremony in which he attacked the system of Bantu education. In his speech, Tiro fearlessly predicted, "The day shall come when all shall breathe the air of freedom with all that is theirs to breathe. And when that day shall come, no man, no matter how many tanks he has, will reverse the course of the events." How prophetic. With Tiro's expulsion, protest spread throughout South African universities for the reinstatement of Tiro to continue his studies. Tiro's lifeline came when given a teaching post by a principal, Lekgao Matabate, at Morris Isaacson High School. This is how his mentor and mentee, Tiro and Mashinini, met. In Tiro, Mashinini encountered the fountain source of black consciousness and the dream that one day South Africa would be renamed Azania.
Thank you.
Sent into exile by the South African Student Organization as a permanent organizer Tiro landed in Botswana only to be killed by a parcel bomb addressed to him by the South African security death squads. Mashinini not only lost a teacher of history and English, but also a political mentor. This was in 1 January 1971. Tiro had a great influence in shaping Mashinini's political thinking, which explains his mentor's adherence to the philosophy of black consciousness. One never gets deviated by the brave giants when they are gone. Tragic as Tiro's death was, and meant to shock, terrorize, and intimidate, it achieved the opposite. Mashinini's irrepressible leadership came shining through to become the chair of the debating team at his school. It is important to mention that Mashinini's bravery was accompanied by a brilliant academic performance. The reason I'm saying this is that you'd find in certain instances people want to go into protest because they are not ready for their exams. With Tsietsi, in through and through the struggle, his academic performance did not fail. Maurice Isaacson's acclaimed science and physics teacher, Fanyana Mazibogo, saw Tsietsi's continued mentorship. While the sister of Song, Letambuli, was searching and surrendering and serenading freedom-loving people with songs like "There Is Music in the Air," anti-colonial winds of change were sweeping through south of Africa. Frelimo clinched its liberation victory in Mozambique in 1974. Samora Machel became the leader. Angola followed in 1976 with Agostinho Neto as president. SWAPO's plans for Namibia's independence also took root. All these were circumstances around which Tsietsi lived his political life. International solidarity action by the PC movement was marked with the 1974 Frelimo rallies in Karis Fountain in Durban. Most were arrested and charged in what was called the Sasso BBC treason trial. The faint-hearted were intimidated to give up, not Mashinini. He joined the BC student wing, the South African student movement. He did not at the time when the South African government was increasingly becoming repressive. On June 30, 1976, about 500 students met at Orlando Donaldson Community Hall to discuss means of confronting and challenging the hated system of Bantu education. There, a decision was taken on stage on June 16 by Tsietsi to lead people against the teaching medium as the source of Africans. You could feel the totality of the struggle when students sang the song Mabawiyeke Umhlaba Wethu. Mashinini was elected chair of the Action Committee. The Action Committee was later renamed Soweto Student Representative Council, with Mashinini serving as its first president. On the morning of June 16, Tsietsi took to the assembly to lead students to meeting points for the march. The march drew more than 20,000 uniformed students joining in a mass demonstration. Matters had clearly gone beyond Africans as a medium of instruction. Liberation had become the overall goal. No violence was planned on the day. The march, Mashinini emphasized, was to be as peaceful with all the care to avoid provocation. In typical brutal force, police responded with live ammunition. In the wake of the day's tragedy, evolving developments, so Tsietsi turned into an instant hero of national and international importance. But hero he was not to the regime. They branded him the enemy of the state. A 500 rand was placed on his head for anyone who could lead to his arrest. A Colonel Force Fesser of the Soweto Criminal Investigation Division made an appeal for Mashinini to hand himself over, warning him that he risked being killed by Anglo hostile residents who had become antagonized by the national uprisings. Fesser went further to ask Mashinini's parents to bring him to the police station. I quote, "We believe that Mashinini is active and moving about Soweto and other townships, but we have never been able to locate him. If you spot him or know where he is, you must report him to the nearest police station." Mashinini left for exile in August 1976. He was met and received by various heads of states and parliamentarians. In Nigeria, he stayed at the presidential guest house in Lagos. He finally settled in Liberia, where he married a daughter of a parliamentarian, Wilma Kamba, in 1978. They had two daughters, Nomkita, named after his mother, and Tembi. Mashinini later moved to the UK and the US, where he addressed the United Nations on the brutalities of the oppressive.